So the next speaker is Professor Yashwant Gupta from the National Center for Radio Astrophysics at TIFR Pune. Professor Gupta did his bachelor's degree at IIT Kanpur. He then did his master's and PhD in radio astronomy from the University of California, San Diego. He has been at NCRA since 1991 in various capacities. He has been associated with GMRT, the Giant Meter Wave Radio Telescope, since 1995 as the chief scientist and since 2010 as the dean of the observatory. He works mainly on pulsars. He's been awarded the Bhatnagar Award, which is the highest award for science in India. That was in 2007. He leads the Indian component of the Square Kilometer Array. As you know, science these days has many international projects, like the Large Hadron Collider in Switzerland, or even the Gravitational Wave Observatory you may have heard about. A new such international collaboration is the Square Kilometer Array, and he leads the Indian component in that big project. Over to you, Professor. Yeah.
Thank you, and let me say at the outset that it's a real privilege to be here and to be able to talk to all of you. After having heard about tigers and wildlife and how to conserve them by understanding the DNA, and then having talked about how to exchange secret messages, it's now time to move out to the outer reaches of the universe, leave all these things down here, and then see what that looks like. And so that's my plan, to take you through a brief journey. And the journey will involve three steps. Start with the part one, which is just some basics of astronomy. Then spend a bit of time talking about the tools that we use and how they help us to study different aspects of the universe. And then part three, a bit about what we've learned from all of this, a bit like a nutshell summary of what we understand of the universe. And so we will see how this journey goes. So I think most of us understand and accept that astronomy is probably the oldest science. And since the time that man maybe became settled as a hunter-gatherer, he started, looked up into the sky and started wondering what the heavens are. And since then has begun this quest to understand the universe. And of course, as you can imagine, it started with us using our naked eyes. And that's an important point, because we do have detectors in our eyes to detect light waves. And we'll see the importance of this as we go along. But however, the growth of astronomy evolved dramatically from the time that the telescope was invented. And this gentleman, Galileo Galilei, turned this recent invention towards the heavens and started looking at objects in the sky. And that revolutionized astronomy forever. And since then, there's a growth of telescopes. So this is a model of the telescope that Galileo used. And then you just see a sequence of how telescopes, optical telescopes, have grown through the ages. This is the model of the telescope that Newton built, which was a reflector as compared to refractors, which were the first telescopes. And then through the times, bigger and bigger and bigger telescopes. These are some of the modern telescopes. These have mirrors which are tens of meters in size. And so that brings us to this first question, that what drives this quest for larger and larger telescopes? So there are two obvious things here. One, which is very simple, the bigger the telescope, the more light it will collect. And therefore, you can see fainter sources. So it's a bit like when you go into a dark room, you dilate your eyes, your pupil becomes wider. You try to take in as much light as possible so that you can see fainter objects in the dark space. So that is what we call sensitivity. How sensitive is the instrument is how faint a signal can it detect. And the detection is against a competing thing, which is the noise, that any detector that you use has a certain amount of noise, unwanted signal, and your desired signal, no matter how faint, should rise above the noise so that you can see it, right? The second thing is that bigger telescopes provide higher magnification, and this is again something that we all know, but what does magnification mean? That means you can distinguish between two objects which are nearby to each other. So you can resolve them. That is, technically we call it resolution, and your ability to see details in an object is your ability to be able to resolve that object. And it so happens that both the sensitivity and the resolution of a telescope increase as you increase the size of the telescope, the aperture D. So the sensitivity goes as D to the power 2, because that's the area over which the signal is being collected, and the resolution goes inversely as the size. So the bigger you make the telescope, the finer it can distinguish between nearby objects in the sky. It also depends on wavelength of the radiation. So if you're using light waves, you would put the value of the wavelength for light, and you can work out what this resolution is in terms of angular separation of objects in the sky that you can distinguish. So that is what then leads to these bigger and bigger telescopes, and so I will illustrate that with a simple example. So when you look at the moon with your naked eye, this is about the best you may be able to manage. With a slightly longer exposure, you can get this kind of image where you can already see the improvement in the ability to see fainter things on the moon, as well as to resolve the shapes and objects on the moon. And if you improve this with a better telescope, you can see a better image, and you can get to this point where you can now see much more detail. You can make out the individual craters, you can see the structures, and so on. So this is this example of how you get higher resolution and a better image quality as you increase the size of the telescope. Similarly, we'll do this for one more example, just so that you can understand what we're talking about, and this will show you both resolution and sensitivity improvement of a telescope. I think all of you would have heard about the Andromeda galaxy. It's one of the nearest galaxies to our Milky Way galaxy, and if you go out in the night sky, maybe from Chennai night skies, you will not see it. So I would urge you to go out of town, go look at the night sky, and in this constellation of Pegasus the horse, you have the constellation, and where you see near these two stars, you see a very faint patch in the sky. It's a galaxy, and you say you can't make out it's a galaxy by looking at it with the naked eye. So you can then go look at it with a small telescope, you will see this hazy patch, and you need really then to put a slightly bigger telescope on it. And now you can see both effects, that you can certainly see much fainter objects in this image, and you can also start seeing that you can see these two nearby stars very close to each other, which are getting resolved. You can see them as separate objects, right? And if you put an even higher capability telescope, this galaxy starts to look like this. And now you can see much more richer detail, and you can see fainter objects, and you can see with even better quality with a better telescope. So this is what we are trying to do, to look at objects in the sky with greater clarity and see more detail and fainter objects. Okay, so we'll now look a little bit more in detail on the tools that we use to do some of these things. And what we started the discussion was with light waves, right? But we all know that light is part of a much wider spectrum of waves, the so-called electromagnetic spectrum, which ranges from the lowest frequency or the largest wavelength, frequency and wavelength are inversely proportional to each other, to the highest frequency waves, which have the smallest wavelength, which are called gamma rays. And this spans a wide range of, so as we found, this is rather sensitive, and sometimes it refuses to Okay, so it spans from the low frequency, large wavelength radio waves to high frequency small wavelength gamma rays, and you know, they're just for comparison, the sizes of different objects as we know them in the universe to for the scale. So from 10 to the 3,000 kilometers to 1 billionth or 1,000 billionth of a kilometer. And the important thing is to ask that, can these different objects in the universe, whether it be stars or galaxies, can the same object emit or be studied at different wavelengths of the electromagnetic spectrum? Do the different wavelengths give us different information about the same object, different physical properties of the object? And even more importantly, are there some objects which can only be studied at some particular wavelengths? That is, they are not visible to us at other wavelengths. And the answer to all of these is yes. And that is what then drives us to this. So my wife caught me in one of these poses, and so when you look at me, I may look like this in an optical picture, but even she doesn't know that if she looks at me with infrared eyes, this is what I would look like, right? And so this is a completely different picture. You see different parts of the body, different objects. And if you, maybe I should stand this side. And if you look at this, so if you subjected me to X-rays, this is what you would likely to see. And so now you can see, you're getting complementary information about the same object by studying it at different wavelengths. And this really is the point that is true for astronomical objects also. And so I illustrate this now with an example of the same Andromeda galaxy. So this is the same picture that we saw, the optical wavelength. This is what the galaxy looks like when you make an image at radio wavelengths. This is what it looks like when you make an image at millimeter wavelengths, infrared, optical, ultraviolet, and X-rays. Once again, you can see that the object looks different at these at different wavelengths. It gives you different information. The galaxy looks much bigger in radio because it tracks the large hydrogen clouds in the galaxy, whereas optical tracks where the stars are, the infrared tracks where the hot dust is in the galaxy, and so on and so forth. Okay, so so this then, once astronomers realize this, that this is possible, this is obviously a very powerful way to probe the universe. Studying the same object in the universe at different wavelengths, and some of those phenomena which can only be seen at some particular wavelengths. But however, as you probably would have realized, there are a few hurdles to overcome before you can do this. And the first of them is the obvious one, that you need the detectors to be able to detect these different radiations. And that is something which we don't have naturally like the eyes. And so that came along with the development of technology. So whether it is photographic plates or charge-coupled devices through which most of these signals are finally picked up and converted into electronic voltages that can then be captured on computers, or radio communication equipment, which is the one that drove radio astronomy. When people built the first radio communication equipment, they found that you can actually detect signals from the universe, accidental discovery, and that's how radio astronomy started. Now, there is another impediment, which is that, and which you would realize very well when you understand that we are protected from ultraviolet radiation from the sun because it is blocked by the ozone layer. So there are different parts of the Earth's atmosphere and ionosphere which block a large fraction of the electromagnetic waves wanting to come in from outside. So if you look at the what we call the opacity, which measures the amount by which the signal will be transmitted through, you find that really there are only two main windows. One, the optical one, which we already use and know about. Another big one over here in the frequency range of the radio frequencies, where the signals can actually come through to us. They are otherwise blocked by various phenomena, whether it is absorption by molecules in the atmosphere, or refraction or absorption in the ionosphere of the Earth, and so on. So what happens then? As you can then imagine, that radio astronomy was then the next branch of astronomy that developed, because you could actually sit on the Earth and be able to detect the signals as long as you had the detectors. And I'll come back a bit later to what happens at the other wavelengths. So let's look more carefully at this new branch, radio telescopes. And in a sense, the radio telescope is no different from your satellite dish, which you use all the time, right? It receives radio signals coming from outside, collects them at a point in the antenna, amplifies them, and then gives them to some device which can record the signal. In the case of your satellite dish, it goes to your set-top box and then to your TV. But there is a big difference. The big difference is in terms of the strength of the signals. So the strength of the signals that we work with are very, 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 very weak. And we measure it in a unit which is 10 to the minus 26 watts per square meter per unit frequency. I won't go into the details of this, nor will I explain this more in detail, except to drive home the point in the following manner. Radio astronomy has been there since the 1950s. If you calculate the total amount of energy that we have collected from all the radio telescopes working since 1950 to today, the direct energy that comes in, it is less than the energy that you spend every morning when you boil your water to make your cup of tea, one individual. Okay? So now you can see, with just that much energy collected over decades, what can you learn about the universe? So that really is the fascinating part of what you can do. But to make that happen, you have to amplify this very weak signal by a very large amount. And again, so the driving factors, large dishes, so that you can collect as much of the signal as possible, and high quality electronics, so that you can amplify this signal faithfully and amplify it well above the noise that the electronics produces. And further then, to improve your ability to observe better, you observe the signal over as large a bandwidth as possible. Unlike your TV transmission, which is confined to some narrow range of frequencies, most natural phenomena in the universe, when they occur, when particles radiate, they radiate over a large range of frequencies. So if you can receive over the large range of frequencies, you get more of the signal. And again, by the same thing, your telescope is more sensitive. And finally, when you still don't have enough of this, you try and observe the source longer and longer and longer and collect as much of the signal as possible, so that again, you can improve the sensitivity of the telescope. So this leads to the attempt to build large antennas. And some of the largest that exist in the world are 100 meters in size, right? So you can imagine 100 meters, that's larger than the size of the hall in which we are sitting. Now, unfortunately, what happens is, if you go back to that resolution formula, so you gain sensitivity, you're increasing the size, you're improving the resolution, but now, mind you, you're at a different wavelength. You saw that range of wavelengths. The radio wavelengths are the longest wavelengths. So this is a very large number, and the resolution that you get with a 100 meter size antenna is only about half a degree. Now you ask, what is half a degree? Half a degree is the size that the moon subtends in the sky. What does that mean? So we go back to our early example. This is the optical image of the moon. If you made an image of the moon, if it was emitting radio waves, which it does at a weak level, you would get an image that looks like this. You can't make out any of the details. That's because the resolution of this 100 meter size antenna is not even good enough to resolve structures on the moon. So you see, radio astronomers have a big disadvantage, that they work at long wavelengths and they can't get high enough resolution. So what did radio astronomers do in order to beat this challenge? It was realized, and this was a work that actually got a Nobel Prize, that instead of building a large antenna to cover the entire area over which you want to collect so that you get high resolution, you can build many small antennas spanning that same region that you would have liked to, collect the signals from all the antennas, do some very smart, clever signal processing, and make an image of the object that you want to study using these antennas. And then you can then get a resolution which now depends on the largest separation of your antennas in the array rather than the size of the single antenna that you use in the array. Okay, so that's a clever trick, and it's a bit like, I can try to give you an analogy. It's like recovering full information about an object by sampling only some parts of the signal. So for example, if you were shown an incomplete jigsaw puzzle, and then suddenly, you know, you can reconstruct what the rest of the image looks like. So it's a bit like this. You are not getting the full information because you don't have, collecting surface over the entire area, but yet you're able to make images which have as much resolution as a big antenna of that size would have had. So this brings the radio astronomer back in the same regime as the optical. You can get the resolutions which are of the order of arc seconds, which is what you would like to be able to compare an image made in optical with an image made in radio in order to get the best of the information about the source. And let me then illustrate this with the example of our own Giant Meter Wave Radio Telescope, which is a low frequency radio telescope. And by low frequency, it means 50 to 1500 megahertz, which are wavelengths which are about 20 centimeters to about a few meters long. And this is an instrument built by our institution. It is one of the largest radio telescopes in the world operating at these low frequencies. 30 antennas, each of 45 meters diameter, and they are spread out over a 28 kilometer size region. This is about 80 kilometers from Pune. If you're traveling from Pune to Nasik, the highway will go past some of the antennas, and then you're welcome to stop by and visit us. So we are synthesizing a 28 kilometer size antenna to get high resolution capability, and it's a bit of fun to see what this thing looks like. So today, if you study anything and you don't Google it, then you are nowhere. So if you go Google, this is what Google will show you, the Google Maps. And so this is that central area of the array, which is a compact area of 12 antennas. And you can actually see individual antennas. And you can see our main receiver building and the control room. And this is a closer view where you can just about make out the antennas. You can zoom this further. And these are some of the closest antennas in the array. And like I said, you need to bring all the signals from the antennas to a common place for the processing that has to be done, and that's done using optical fiber, and all the fibers end up in a receiver room in this building over here, where you convert the signal back to an electrical voltage and then do all this processing, which allows you to make this image by combining the signals from 30 antennas. And I'll show you in a minute some of that. So once again, to drive home the point, these are huge antennas. So this is the kind of a service crane which is needed, and that goes up to a height of 30 meters when people have to go work there to install some of the electronics that sits at the focus of the antenna. So a complicated observatory like this needs many pieces of technology and engineering. And I'm not going to go through any of these in detail, but just to give you a feel that all the way from mechanical systems to the servo system, which has to move these antennas accurately as they track the objects in the sky as they rise and set, to the antennas which pick up the signal, to the receivers, optical fibers, digital electronics, control system, which automatically controls all the antennas from the central control room and manages the whole observatory, and then the offline data processing software, which allows you to finally make the images and get the signals that you want of interest. So, like I said, I'm not going to go into the details of this, and just to tell you that this observatory was completed almost 15 years ago and is dedicated as a global facility for research by astronomers from all over the world, and astronomers from all over the world do come and use it. So it has about 50% of the users from within the country, The remaining 50% come from a whole host of nations which practice astronomy, and it's heavily in demand. It's measured by an oversubscription rate, that there's a certain amount of time available on the telescope for doing experiments. You put in a proposal saying, I'd like to do the following experiment. Others put in the proposal. You count the total request, and you find that demand is more than the supply by a factor of 2.5. And that leads to competition. The best proposals for the best kind of science projects are then selected by a selection panel, and then the time is allocated, and the experiments are scheduled in a continuous cycle for almost 6 months. Okay, so like I said, it's been working for the last 15 years as an international facility. Lots of interesting results have been produced. And we are currently in the process of upgrading it to a next generation facility to improve its sensitivity by more than a factor of two. Again, sensitivity is the ability to see fainter and weaker sources in the universe, and also increase its frequency coverage so that it can see many other kinds of sources, so that we can keep it on the forefront in the global scenario for at least the next decade or so. Okay, so back to what happens at wavelengths where the signal cannot penetrate the Earth's atmosphere, and then you need space-based observatories. So you, and that again was enabled the moment man learned how to send rockets, actually even before rockets, high-flying aircraft into very high atmosphere where you can at least beat some of the infrared problems. But bulk of this wavelength regimes are studied with space-based observatories. You'll also find some space-based observatories in the visible range, and you know the Hubble Space Telescope, and I'll leave that for a question if somebody asks. But here are some of the space-based telescopes. As you can see, from infrared wavelengths to optical to gamma rays to X-rays, each specialized for that particular range of wavelengths, built according to that with the right kind of technology, the detectors, and finally transmitting the signals back to Earth for making the final images and analysis. So this is what has allowed us to span the entire universe, and I'd like to just again make a point about what has been India's contribution in this field. And I think many of you would know that India has its own space-based observatory called the AstroSat, which combines different payloads, four different payloads, which cover frequency ranges mainly in the ultraviolet and the X-rays, and different kinds of X-ray detectors to cover different parts of the spectrum or wavelengths of the X-rays, because again, that's a very large range of wavelengths, but like the radio window. And this, again, like the GMRT, is a completely indigenous effort with payloads built by scientists from different institutions, Tata Institute, Indian Institute of Astrophysics, IUCA in Pune, and ISRO, and then finally, of course, launched on a PSLV by ISRO year before last. And and it's really nice to know that the observatory, since launch, after the initial rounds of tests and characterizations, is now working well, is producing good quality science, and it's one of the leading facilities in the world in the ultraviolet range, as well as some parts of the X-ray window that it covers. Okay, so with that, I'll move to part three, which is that with all this that we've done, what is it that we've learned about the universe? Now, again, it's not possible to cover all of that in a short talk like this, so I'll just give you a few glimpses, and again, leave the rest for somebody who really has more detailed questions. So what are the questions we are trying to ask? What are the basic constituents of the universe? For example, you know planets, you know stars. Then there are objects which are gas clouds, clouds of neutral hydrogen gas, clouds of ionized gas, molecular gas. A lot of the universe is gas. Okay, and you may take that with a, in a lighter vein, but that is what it is. And I mean, the stars are balls of gas, right? And But there are many exotic objects like neutron stars, quasars, black holes, some of which you probably all know quite a bit about. But again, I won't have time to go delve into the details of these. There is something else, which I will spend a bit of time later at the end, that this is all matter that we see in the sense that it emits electromagnetic radiation in some part or the other of that whole spectrum that I showed you. And so you can detect it using these different detector technologies that we talked about. But there is matter out there, which is called dark, which does not interact in terms of producing any electromagnetic radiation, but it does interact in terms of the force of gravity with other matter, that is the normal matter, and it's therefore inferred, the presence is inferred, and we still don't know what it consists of. I'll talk a little bit more later on. The other kind of questions that we can ask is, what is the size and scale of the universe? And I'll show you in a minute that it is a hierarchy of structures that we see in the universe. You could ask, how old is the universe? And we have some answers to these kind of questions, 14 billion years. And what is the evolutionary history of the universe? And I'll again talk a little bit about it. And there are lots of exotic phenomena which we see in the universe, which the physics of which you cannot reproduce in any lab on the Earth. And then therefore, they are excellent teaching grounds for advancing ideas of physics, which, you know, reach up to a certain point, and you say, well, what lies beyond this, I cannot demonstrate to you in the lab. You can demonstrate it in the lab in the universe. Okay, so planets. You know, till a few years ago, if you ask somebody planets, they would say, yeah, Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, blah, 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 that's it, that's all I know, right? And today, I think you all know that there are hundreds of planets that have been discovered, what we call exoplanets, planets around others nearby stars. We are still talking about the near universe, in nearby galaxy, our galaxy. And the observatory Kepler, again, one of these ones in outer space, that has really revolutionized the field and helped us to find lots of planets around nearby stars. And you'd have heard the news 2 days ago about these 7 rocky Earth-like planets found around one star. And so we have gone well beyond our solar system, and the attempt is now to characterize potentially habitable planets in the universe, and with this distant dream that someday we'll find somebody, someday we may be able to go visit them, or they may come visit us, or whatever, right? Beyond that, stars. How many? 100 billion in our galaxy. So no problems like tigers, there's no issue here. There's enough of them spread out all over the place, right? And you thought that they all should be like the sun? No, the smallest stars are 10 kilometers in size. And they have as much matter as the sun, that is the neutron stars. They are smaller than Chennai, okay? And there are the big guys, 100 times bigger than our sun. Okay, so this is a wide range. Again, I can't go into the details of that. Nebulae, so these are the ones that I talked about, clouds of gas. And if you thought there are no pretty pictures in the universe, there are lots of pretty pictures of all kinds. Gas under different conditions, heated by stars, heated by supernova explosions, shock waves. And there is as much matter in our galaxy in form of gas and nebulae as the 100 billion stars. So you could make another 100 billion stars from that gas. That's how stars are formed, from clouds of gas collapsing under the force of gravity. Okay, so that tells you how much matter there is in our galaxy. And then how many galaxies are there that we know in the universe? 200 billion such galaxies, right? And that's the current count. It keeps fluctuating. We keep finding that count is wrong. It needs to be revised upwards. And so there is a rich variety of phenomena. And these objects are arranged in a hierarchy of structures. So when you start from the Earth in a solar system, that is planets around star, clusters of stars, our neighborhood, then many such neighborhoods in a galaxy, a cluster of galaxies in the local group of galaxies in which Andromeda, the galaxy that we saw earlier, is a part of our group. Then clusters of galaxies, superclusters of galaxies, where each supercluster of galaxies may contain of the order of million galaxies kind of a thing. And so all of that is a hierarchy of scales which extends up to what we call the observable universe. That's the limit to which we know the universe. Whether the universe has further, space or even more dimensions beyond that is something that we are still trying to understand. Similarly, we can reconstruct age and evolutionary history of the universe. And again, you have all heard Big Bang, right? That's how the universe started back 14 billion years ago. And it evolved, we think it evolved in this kind of a fashion where there were the initial dust and gas from the explosion, the first cores of galaxies called quasars formed, then a large multitude of galaxies evolving, moving apart because we understand the universe is expanding, and then galaxies forming in these, collecting in local groups, and then, this at a point when we are in the present where we have a stable arrangement with our own galaxy, which is stable for several billions of years, but would change eventually. Then moving further beyond, like I said, we think we know a lot, but we found out recently that, and I deliberately put this not fully upside down because this has turned our understanding of the universe somewhat upside down, that all this stuff that I showed you is only less than 5% of the universe, all these billions of galaxies. There is this dark matter which I talked about, which we can infer from gravitational interaction, which we believe makes up 23% of the universe. And then there is something even more mysterious, which is called the dark energy, which is again inferred from certain observational constraints, which is about the speed at which the universe is expanding, that is actually slowing down, and there is a force which has to have a cause in terms of the equivalent mass, and that makes up 72% of the universe, of which we know nothing except to guess what it is. So the point I was trying to make here, which is where I'll stop, is that we've come a long way from the time when man first looked up in the sky to understand a lot about the universe. And there's an amazing amount of things that we have learned, and we keep discovering more interesting things in the detail. But as I've shown very quickly in a snapshot, there is still lots more to be learned about the universe. And this journey will likely continue for, I think, as long as mankind is there. So with that, I'll stop. And I don't know if you've got any SMSs or not.
Thank you. Let's move to the center. Thank you so much. We indeed have lots and lots of SMS messages and questions from other sources. Everybody wants to know lots of things about the stars. So let's put to you some of the questions. Have there been any radio signals in the past or in the recent past that have led us to speculate about extraterrestrial beings?
Yeah. So the quick answer to that is no. But the detailed answer is that there have been times when we've been fooled to think that we've got signals. So I didn't go into this neutron stars. Neutron stars, when they were discovered, neutron stars emit regular pulses of radiation, a bit like your ECG, tuck, 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 they go. And you say, well, when they were first discovered, people ask, how can some natural phenomena be doing this? Okay, it must be somebody signaling to us. But then very soon, when you start looking at the objects in detail, you realize this is not somebody signaling to us, it's a natural phenomena. So yes, there is organized activity as part of radio astronomy to sift through all these signals that we get to look for an underlying intelligence signal. And there's a very large branch of radio astronomy that does that. Millions of dollars are poured into that exercise. So far, it has proved fruitless. It is, when you think of a needle in a haystack, this is a problem which is, millions of times worse than a needle in a haystack. You don't even know what the needle looks like, and you don't even know how big the haystack is, and you don't even, yes, but man is man, and he will try as long as it's possible to find these things.
I was a little curious too. So when you have these big radio telescopes, there must be all kinds of noise you must be getting from just radio broadcasts from other parts.
Yes, you're right. So what we do, we may have messed up with the environment and the tigers, but we are also messing up with what astronomers can do by our man-made activities. And in fact, the biggest enemy of radio astronomy is man-made electromagnetic activity, whether it is your mobile phones or it is the TV signals that we receive or the satellite beaming down all your favorite channels, and so on and so forth. And a lot of work has to be done by observatories to guard against these unwanted signals, both in terms of the technology as well as the politics, interacting with the right agencies to keep the menace down to a minimum. But yes, it is true. And again, you know, you have to separate those out when you're looking for these weak signals of different kinds.
Okay. So the next question is from SMS, from a number that ends in 1729, the Ramanujam number. Amri would have been very happy to get this question. But okay, here it goes. So you showed us a picture of Andromeda as we see it, but how can we get a picture of the Milky Way?
That's a good question. There are pictures of the Milky Way, which you, what you do is an internal reconstruction. So you look out from inside the Milky Way, and you look in different directions, you see different sources, different objects, and then you, and there are ways in which you can then try to put that information together and say, this is what our galaxy looks like, and if you were looking at it from outside, this is what it would look like. It is a galaxy which is somewhat similar to the Andromeda in terms of its size and its mass and the shape, like typically a spiral galaxy. Of course, galaxies come in different shapes also. Yes, you can infer what a galaxy would look like.
So that is actually related to the next question. Why are most of the galaxies you showed disc-shaped? Is there any mathematical reason for that?
Okay. That's another good question. So there is a mathematical model which says that when you take a large cloud of gas, and again, like stars and solar systems, galaxies also coalesce out of you know, a large cloud of hydrogen gas coming together. You can show that if you have a cloud and it is spinning with some certain angular momentum, that ball of gas, when it finally settles down to produce an object, whether it is a star with the solar system or if it's a galaxy, most of those have this disc-shaped structure. Our solar system is also a long extended disc, except that it's not filled completely. It has, you know, planets going around in orbits at certain distances in it. So it is, there is a physics which can give you this.
Okay. How about this? Do wormholes exist? Is there a way to detect them? What about black holes?
Fine.
This is from Tamar Kumaran on Facebook.
Fine. Yes, that has to be there. Black holes, the existence of black holes is an inferred quantity. So there's a physical model which says that when stars which are beyond a certain mass in their life, the central core of the star has to keep collapsing because nothing is holding it up against gravity. At a certain stage, it forms a neutron star, the 10-kilometer object I talked about. But if the original star is bigger and heavier, then that collapse does not stop, and it forms what is called a black hole. It's a mathematical construct. The construct is such that it is very difficult to verify its presence by seeing a signal from it, like you would see light or radio waves or X-rays. But you can infer its presence because it will interact gravitationally with other objects, right? So for example, if the sun switched off its light, the ball of gas will still be there. It will still be pulling the earth and we'll still be going around it. And so you find that you're still moving around, then you can infer that there is a big object in the center around which we are going. So the same thing works for inferring the black holes. And then when you do that inference, you find that these are very heavy objects confined to a very small amount of space. And that's the thing of saying that, yes, I have detected a black hole. So black holes are detected or inferred in by this indirect method that I just described, and quite a few are thought to be there in our galaxy, as well as a large big black hole is supposed to be at the center of our galaxy, and most galaxies have at their centers large black holes, which can have as much as 1 million times the mass of the sun. So 1 million suns compressed into that black hole. Wormholes are again a mathematical construct, and there I don't think there is any evidence that we have saying that, well, because of this I can then infer that there is a wormhole.
Maybe you can even just say what a wormhole is.
So there is a mathematical which constructs which asks what happens to matter that keeps falling into a black hole, because black hole has such a large gravitational force it will keep pulling matter. And there's a mathematical construct which says that there's a way in which you can get this matter transformed and come out via a wormhole. Okay, so now at that point I'll stop, because it is really a mathematical construct, and there is no way of today that we have of verifying such entities.
Okay, let's just take one more question. We'll take some more questions at the end of the last talk too. So just one last question now. It is said that when we look at the sky, we're looking at the past of a star. How do we know, or how are we sure, that things that we see are still there now?
That's a very good question. So first, I didn't go into that because I had limited time. But it is correct that when we look into the universe, we are looking back into the past, for the simple reason that the information that we see travels at the speed of light. That is, again, a construct which says nothing in the universe travels faster than the speed of light. It's fast, but it is finite. Therefore, when you see something which is a million light years away, then the light started from there a million years ago. And therefore, when it has reached you, it is telling you about the condition of that object as it existed a million years ago, right? So when I see you, you are probably a picosecond older than, but it doesn't matter at that level, right? But there, when it becomes millions of years, it matters, right? Now, this other question is interesting. So yes, in principle, if the life of that object that you're looking at was much less than a million years, then sure, when you got this signal from it a million years later, that object may not exist today. It is possible. I mean, may not exist means it may have changed its form into something else. Like if it was a star, it may have died like this, and someday the sun will go through that kind of a stage and so on. But yes, in principle, those things are possible.
Thank you. On that note, we'll go to the next speaker.